I'm asking for a show of hands for how many people were at this meeting last year. That's enough for me to skip one or two of my slides at the beginning. That's good. I'm here from the BMJ group. So as many of you will know, we take our name from our flagship title, the BMJ, which is a very old journal. It's been going since the 19th century. General clinical medicine journal, high impact factor, so forth, high rejection rate. You're probably familiar with it. What you might not know is that we publish another sort of 42 titles, generally into sort of specific specialties like gastroenterology or cardiology. And we have sort of 40 or so of those. From an open access perspective, the BMJ went online with bmj.com in the mid-90s with, I think at that point, everything that it was putting up there free to access. Open access as a concept, I think, not sort of really around in the mid-90s. And since then, all research in that journal has been available free, as was, or open access as is now, and it was the first general medical journal into PubMed Central. And with the exception of case reports, all our other journals are hybrid with our unlocked scheme. And that's the reason why I asked who was here last year. If you want any more information about what the BMJ group has been doing with open access, I commend last year's website. So the point of that being to sort of introduce the BMJ group, but also to say that we've got quite a long-standing relationship with free or open access content. Our unlocked scheme was one of the first. But maybe we haven't done an awful lot new in that field relatively recently, but that has now changed with the launch of BMJ Open. So I'll blitz you with a few stats to begin with. It's an open access journal for clinical medical research. We started publishing in February. We turned our submission system on about this time last year. We've had over 300 submissions so far, and those are going up. I've got a graph you'll be pleased to hear. And like the other journals that we've heard about in this session, we're peer reviewing content without concern for novelty, impact, or citability, and instead focusing our reviewers' attention on sound and ethical methods, sensible discussion, and proper reporting. It's the author pays model. The APC is £1,200, and there are sort of the usual waiver policies. Hinari countries, submitting authors from Hinari countries will receive a full waiver. Other people who don't have the means to pay can apply for waivers after the article's been accepted, so we don't enter into any discussions about that kind of thing or ask for any payment-related information until an article's been accepted. Our license is the Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial license, and we are currently, or will be very soon, found in all the usual indexes. So we're publishing original clinical medical research from protocols all the way through to meta-analyses and everything in between. We do try and make sure that articles are what authors say they are. So we have had some authors try to perhaps get preliminary results in as protocol papers or small, very small studies that are so small that they really can't tell you anything in as pilot studies, for example. So if somebody submits a pilot study, we're quite rigorous. We do say you've got to explain clearly what was being piloted here, not just that it was a small study, what was actually being piloted here. And we'll take preliminary locally relevant research as long as it's cautiously interpreted, and we'll take negative studies. And that emphasis on cautious interpretation is important for us because we think it speaks really to the credibility of the journal that we don't have people making some outrageous claims for the work that they've done. And that's why one of the features that we've introduced is this strengths and limitations section, which we insist every article carries. And again, we're quite strict on these. We ask our reviewers to pay special attention to these, and as much as possible in-house we'll look at them as well, because it's not acceptable to say a limitation of this study is that we failed to cure cancer. You know, it's, you know, it's got to be a little bit more detailed than that. And again, we think it just speaks to the credibility overall of the journal. We are receiving original submissions. We're having articles that are submitted directly to us, as well as working from what most people know, I think, is the cascading method. So authors can choose to transfer their articles to BMJ Open from other BMJ group journals if they've been unsuccessful when submitting there. We weren't able to do that originally, unfortunately, because we launched on a new submission system. We launched on Scholar One, while all our other titles were on Bench Press. They've all now moved over, but that was certainly something to file under the challenges section, because it meant we had to do a lot of manual work. We've been able to publish articles based entirely on reviews received by the papers at other journals, which is good, because that's a great service to authors. It maximizes the value of those reviews, and it means that, you know, authors are getting what they want. Their work has been peer reviewed, they've taken on board those corrections, and it's been published, just not necessarily in the original journal that they thought it might be. And because we have a very limited amount of editorial crossover with the BMJ, but we run from the same offices, we've also been able to give a bit more profile to some of our papers by publishing them in conjunction with BMJ. If they've come to BMJ Open from BMJ, and maybe they were submitted for a themed issue, or they were submitted as part of a suite of papers that the BMJ was putting out on a particular topic, we've been able to coordinate with them, as long as it hasn't entailed holding up publishing the article that's come to us by more than a day or two. I mentioned the BMJ quite a bit, and its accept rate is extremely low, and that's obviously one of the reasons why the group thought about setting up a journal like this. Its accept rate is around 7%, and that's on submissions of several thousand a year. And many of our other journals, they're receiving submissions in the order of 1,500, 2,000, 2,500 research submissions every year, and again, may only have accept rates of 10%. And so that means that thousands of articles were leaving the group. Before BMJ Open came into being, and on our previous submission system, we again had this option to cascade articles from one journal to another. But we really just found that wasn't working. We weren't really keeping that many articles in the group, because we don't have many journals that can compete with each other. We have a few general journals, but most of the other time we just have one cardiology journal, one neurology journal, and so on. So a lot of our editors were really pleased to hear about this journal. Many of them are on the editorial board, and two or three have already published in BMJ Open, which is gratifying. And it means that we're now able to ensure any well-conducted study has a home where it can be fully reported. One potentially thorny issue in medical publishing is that of industry-led research, where industry obviously is the pharmaceutical industry. And we're quite keen to receive this type of work for the reasons that are outlined on the slide there. Pharmaceutical companies are put under a lot of pressure by editorials in journals like the BMJ to get all their data out there. They have lots of data, maybe it doesn't all get published if maybe the trials don't go the way they want, etc. And they come under a lot of pressure to publish this, but when they submit it to journals, because the work is non-definitive, it will generally get rejected. Well, now with a journal like BMJ Open, it means we're sort of putting our journal development plan where our ethical mouth is, if you like, because we will, as long as everything is properly, transparently reported and gets through peer review, we'll publish it. So the editorial case is really one of widening author choice. And one other thing that we're able to do, because the journal is entirely ours, and is new, unlike many of our specialty journals, which are co-owned with societies or contract journals, we're able to sort of play around with it, because in a way we have nothing to lose. We don't have an existing author base, or didn't have an existing author base, we didn't have an existing reviewer base, and while we get a bit of name recognition because we're BMJ open, we thought let's see what we can do with this. So we've introduced some new editorial policies, which I'll talk about in a bit, and some new features like Mendeley links and article level metrics that we've got before any of our other journals. But there is a business case, of course, as well, which certainly involves being able to maximize the value that we get from peer review and the value that we get from handling such a large volume of articles that we were putting a lot of time and editorial effort into, but then we're not doing anything with at the end. And as I mentioned, although we have sort of 40 specialty titles, we don't have a journal for every specialty. We can, for example, publish articles about gastroenterological cancers in gut, but we don't have a specific oncology journal, we don't have a specific diabetes journal or obstetrics and gynecology journal. So a journal like BMJ Open, which is a general medical journal, we can use to push into areas where there's maybe not much business sense in launching a whole new journal from scratch. Who's publishing in BMJ Open? A lot of newish authors, but also a lot of experienced, highly cited authors, professors, and consultants. We're getting repeat authorship, which is gratifying. It means we must be doing something right. And authors from all around the world. I think we've had about 50 countries represented by submitting author so far. And those are a couple of examples of those. The article by Dr. Hobson there, who's a first-time author, that's his first published paper, whereas that article from the Strobe Group, which many of you will be familiar with, included authors like Professor Altman, who's extremely well-known in the fields of reporting and methods and statistics. I'll go into a little bit more detail about peer review and run the risk of repeating what people have talked about earlier, but in order to try and focus our reviewers' minds on the kind of things that we want them to think about, we have a checklist of about 20 questions, which is divided up into three areas. One we call the study, which is mainly the methodological stuff. Is the research question clear? Is there, in fact, a research question? Are the methods clearly reported? Would the work be reproducible? Are the stats appropriate? And so on. Have appropriate reporting statements like Consort or Strobe been used? A section about the results and the conclusion. Again, we're asking questions about, are they credible? Are they clear? Are they sensible when it comes to the conclusions? And then there's a section on publication and research ethics. But there's free text availability as well. So if the reviewers want to elaborate on any of their points, they can do that. The peer review is external, though we're able to reuse, when possible, reviews that other journals have solicited. And most papers, if they're new to BMJ Open, if they're new to the group and they haven't received external peer review elsewhere, will generally be published after one round of revision. We don't have external handling editors. It's run in-house through me, and part of my role is to find the reviewers and then, based on the reviewer reports, make the decisions on the articles. And we also have, I'm a managing editor, we also have an editor-in-chief who's Jess Groves, whose picture I showed you earlier, who was talking here last year. She's deputy editor of the BMJ, but she also has an editorial oversight role on BMJ Open as well. So we're the first journal in the BMJ group to use open peer review, and this is one of the ways that we took BMJ Open and thought, what can we do that's new with it? We could pare it down and we could do sort of the bare minimum required to call it a journal, but let's see what we can do to push it in different directions. So reviewers unblinded. Reviewers know whose work they're reviewing, and authors, when they receive their reviews, will know who performed that review. And in an effort to make that even more transparent, it's all then online. We have a link to the review history, which is the reviews that were received along with the author's responses to those reviews. And the previous versions. So if anybody is so interested, they can take the reviews and they can match them up to the versions of the article that the reviewer was actually looking at. And then in terms of post-publication review, we've got sort of the usual stuff, really. We have e-letters for more formal responses. We were the first journal to have discuss commenting from our group, which has more Web 2.0 functionality and links out to other sites and brings in comments from blogs and Twitter. And we've got article usage statistics as well. And again, those are updated daily, and we were the first journal in the group to roll those out. The other main area where we're trying to use BMJ Open as a bit of a spearhead for the group is the field of open data. And I won't talk too much about this because you could have, and there are sort of whole conferences about this kind of thing, but we've adopted the BMJ's policy of insisting that every article has a data sharing statement. And the idea behind this is sort of quite similar to the idea behind a competing interests statement, whereby people are expected not just to say if they have a competing interest, but also to state clearly if they don't. So it's on the record and not left as something that users of the literature can just infer. So even if the data sharing statement just says that there is no further data available, every article should, and with the exception of one or two that slipped through the net when we launched, will have a data sharing statement. So we're using that to try and push awareness as much as anything else. It's increasingly important for funders. It's increasingly talked about at the publishing conferences, and it's increasingly going to be something that authors are going to have to think about. And that last point there is just what our vision perhaps of the ideal article collection would be for a BMJ Open article, which would be to publish the protocol, to publish the resulting research 18 months, 2 years down the line, along with its pre-publication history, any post-publication comments, and a link out to the data set. And that's where we have the data sharing statement, and we have all the other things that a good journal has: provenance and peer review, ethics approval, competing interests, funding statements, and so on. So we're pushing data sharing as much as we can, but it's quite difficult because it's something which is certainly very new in the field of clinical medicine. It's not so new if you're working in sort of genetics, perhaps. But we wanted to try and do something other than just say this is a good thing and you should be doing it. So one thing that we've done to try and, again, nudge authors towards doing it is integrate our Scholar One system with the Dryad repository. Now, if you work in evolutionary biology and ecology, you're probably familiar with Dryad by now. It's an international repository of data underlying peer-reviewed articles in basic and applied biosciences, and they'll provide a citable reference and a DOI for data sets that are deposited with them. We're encouraging authors to use them. We've had very low take-up, single figures so far. The bottom line being that there's, in sort of real politic terms, if you like, there's just not very much in it for authors at the moment. They won't be rewarded for doing it, and they may well feel penalized for doing it because they feel that it's their data, and if they still got scope to get another two or three articles out of it, then why should they give it to anybody else? But that's just an example of a way that we're using this new journal to try and push into areas that perhaps it would be harder to push into with a traditional journal. Kind of challenges we've been facing, again, at last year's COASP and at various meetings since, there were numbers presented from the SOAP study, which in terms of the availability of funding for medical research authors weren't necessarily sort of super optimistic. But so far, we've had a payment rate of about 70-75%, so it's not an insurmountable challenge, I think. Like other journals that have spoken today, we've got to differentiate ourselves from our big sister, BMJ. They are also open access, as I mentioned, for their research. Their policy on payment is slightly different. They're slightly or considerably less persistent I suppose, or they don't ask any questions. Waivers are no questions asked really with the BMJ, whereas with BMJ Open, we take the view that if the request seems reasonable, then fine, we'll let it pass. But if there's something which seems not quite accurate, for example, the funding statement states that the work was funded by a major international funding body that we know will pay APCs, then we're not shy about going back to authors and saying, well, this is your funder's policy, so can you go away and just double check, please, for us. One thing that we haven't had too much of a problem with, though, I think, is people reviewing for us and thinking that they're reviewing for the BMJ. We've had a few, but on the whole, not many. And when that happens, we've been able to go back to authors and say, well, we can just cut out this bit, or you can re-review. It's up to you. We've had a few technical issues. We were the first journal to go on to Scholar One, and we're the only journal in the group with a continuous publication model of publishing. The rest generally use these online first model. We've had a few objections to our transparent peer review, so that open peer review process. Few people anyway have emailed back and said, I won't review, I disagree, I don't want any part of this craziness. Again, single figures, but obviously we don't know how many people have declined to review for those reasons and not told us, and similarly we don't know if it's put anybody off submitting. It may have done, but we launched with those policies, so we just don't know. And then there are the challenges that any new journal faces, which is, you know, competition for reviewers and authors. That's our submissions graph. It's going up, which is good. There's one extra data point there that wasn't on Mark's graph earlier, because I gave him the data in August, and that's August's point. And why has it gone up? Couldn't say for certain. Probably just more people hearing about the journal, and also we've got now all of our journals onto Scholar One, which means doing that cascading peer review is now much easier. We've got some encouraging press coverage for some of our articles. One of our launch articles, and it was entirely coincidental that we had this article at launch, about locked-in syndrome, received a lot of coverage, and the author was interviewed on national radio. And that story about designer drugs and analog insulin appeared on the BMJ, on the BBC, sorry, news website this morning. And just a few more stats and points to finish off with. Our accept rate has sort of settled down around 55-60% at the moment, which is maybe a little bit lower than I thought it would be, and a little bit higher than one or two other people in-house thought it would be. So that's where it's been for about the last sort of four or five months or so. Nobody's really talked about payment rates so far, but our rate at the moment is fluctuating around 70-75%, and that's people that we have asked to pay, so that doesn't include people who were submitting, say, from Hinari List 1 countries, who we could just give a waiver to without asking. 70-75% of people paying something, not necessarily the full APC. About 50% have paid the full APC so far. Decisions are being returned on average in around 3 weeks. And just to put our kind of publication rate into some context for the rest of our group, by the end of the year, we'll probably have published around 150 articles or so in our first year. And that would mean that we're about the size, in terms of research article output, of many of our specialty journals. So we're quietly confident that at least by the end of next year, we'll be the biggest journal by output, not necessarily by submission, but by output in the group. And I'm going to finish with just this one last point, which is that we've managed to fulfill our first aim, which is to provide rapid publication for articles that are coming in that need very little or possibly no work doing on them if they've been reviewed elsewhere. But with the right reviewers, we've also been able to, I think rehabilitate is not quite the right word, but we've been able to sort of improve articles that were in such a state that they wouldn't get past the first stage of sort of pre-review even at most journals. Not because they're necessarily not interesting or because the scope is narrow, but just because the reporting's been quite poor, and the article in itself is just not in that greater state. But the reviewers have identified that actually, if the rest of the paper can be brought up to scratch, if it can, then there's valid information in there which it's worth getting out into the public domain, and it's possibly even more rewarding sometimes when we're able to do that, which we have been able to do on a few occasions, as it is to provide a swift publication process for those people who, you know, are experienced authors. They know what they're doing and they just need a quick process to publish their paper. And on that teary-eyed note, I will finish.
So you said you don't use an external editorial board. You personally find reviewers and make the decisions.
At the moment, yes, that's what we do. We do have an international editorial board, but they're more the traditional editorial advisory board. So they've stepped in, some of them, when we've not been able to find reviewers or sort of, as and when they've been needed.
Yeah, so, I mean, as far as I know, I think you're the only journal of this type that just trying to do it that way rather than a distributed external board. How scalable do you think that's going to be?
Well, we're open to change, but at the moment we felt that was probably the most efficient way to go about it. So how long that will last will depend entirely on the rate that submissions go up. I don't think we'd have a situation where there would be sort of 8 or 10, even 5 sort of in-house managing editors, but for the moment we thought that this was probably the most efficient way of going about it.
I don't think this is so much a question directed to you, but maybe more broadly, thinking of all of the presentations today in this session. When I'm out talking about OWASPA and open access publishing, I oddly find myself at almost every meeting defending PLOS and PLOS One. You have no idea, and it's a good thing that I know Mark so well and I've heard the spiel so many times that I probably could be your best salesperson out there. And it's because there's misunderstanding that it's peer review light. Is this then just vanity publishing because you'll publish everything? And I think we've worked so hard to kind of get rid of that. And I'm just wondering, since one of the things in common with all of these journals is that you're taking content that was sort of rejected elsewhere and giving it, you know, a potential home. And I believe everyone that there is high standards and quality and whatnot. But I'm just wondering now if I'm going to be going around and sort of defending all of you, and I'll need all of your slides, and that my next great challenge is to defend us again against these claims of vanity publishing and dumping and all of this kind of thing. So I think, I don't know if that was a question or a comment. And I believe all of you, but I'm just, you know,
I would say
see what's coming here.
From our perspective, that was also one of the incentives behind open peer review. So not just that it's considered to be a good thing to bring more transparency to the process and to give credit to reviewers for the work that they're doing, but it does also mean that if people think, well, they're not really reviewing stuff, are they? Well, you know, for our journal at least, people can go away and form their own opinion on the standard of the peer review.
That's one of my concerns as well. You know, I spend a lot of my time battling, you know, this misperception, and it would be a shame if, you know, the crop of mega journals that are launching somehow get smeared with this brush of, well, they're just the journal of rejections, and it's just, you know, they're seen as a very sort of low quality tier which only filters down content from our top tier journals, whatever that means. And you know, we definitely we've heard that a lot in PLOS. We've spent years sort of trying to change the perception, and I think people just need to be a bit careful that they don't sort of launch with that perception almost.
One comment from myself on that. I think there are some extremists within science publishing or on the sort of academic side who may say, okay, 80% of stuff which gets published should never be published. But mostly, there's a recognition that maybe 70% of what gets submitted as scientific research will get published somewhere, and actually that's a reasonable thing to happen. But the existing way that happens is a huge waste of resources for publishers and for the academic community. And what PLOS ONE and other journals are doing is saying, let's kind of cut some of the stages out of getting that 70% published.
So my understanding is there are about 35,000 titles out there, and there's definitely a kind of trickle-down effect. You start off at a certain aim, you want to publish someplace, and either it doesn't quite fit the subject area or the focus of that journal, so you go to another journal and so on and so forth. But these mega journals are obviously providing a much shorter route to publication. Has there been any evidence that any of those other smaller 35,000 journals that are out there have folded as a result of the existence of these mega journals? And does anyone have a sense of when you might have an answer to whether that's going to have that kind of effect in the industry?
If that's a question specifically for me, then I'm afraid I don't have any information on that. I don't know if anybody else does.
Yeah, so I guess I can try and respond to that. I don't think we have any evidence that anyone's gone out of business. And PLOS ONE is you know, by far the biggest example we're talking about. We're only going to publish 14,000 articles this year, and there's roughly 25,000 journals in the world. So effectively, we've only taken one article per journal away, you know, on average. So that's not going to put anyone out of business. So obviously, if we grow a lot larger, I think the effect is, you know, it's obviously going to be there, obviously. I mean, another question is, and I think I saw you tweeting this, how much of this stuff we're publishing is sort of new content that wouldn't have been published otherwise, and how much of it is eating into the pie? And again, you know, it's hard to tell at our volume. We're only 1.5%. But just looking at our content, I think the vast majority of it, probably 90%, would have been published somewhere else. A small proportion, 10%, looks like it's much more incremental work than you would normally expect to see published. So it is publishable, but it's perhaps wouldn't have been, you know, a big enough, you know, paper to publish in a regular venue.
I think to be fair as well, that was a question that was asked by some of our specialty journal editors. You know, what effect on my journal is BMZ Open going to have? Is it going to take away papers that would have been coming to my journal? But you know, we looked and we thought no. It, you know, we were able to convince them that they weren't really taking. You know, on the whole, they weren't taking articles from other journals within the BMJ group already. And you know, if they, on the whole, we think if those editors do a good job of looking after their journals and concentrate not just on the research but on all the other sort of added value content, if you like, reviews and editorials and so forth, then there's plenty of scope for those journals still to flourish.
I actually wonder whether, listening to these mega journal discussions, whether we're going to approach this tipping point. And my thought about it was, if I think about PubMed and I think about what goes on in that community, PubMed and the other services at NLM get enormous amount of activity. Now, if that was a for-profit organization, I'm sure there would be business models and ways to monetize that in a big way. And what you start to think about is certain mega journals could actually get to the size where they would have enough content to layer those services on top that would actually monetize. And if those services were actually useful enough to the authors, that would actually pull more authors into the mega journal model because they see the value in it, and you're going to be left with a few mega journals. And I think at that point, those mega journals will be forced to have some level of interoperability.
That does make me think about the slightly worrying precedent of the American Chemical Society, which kind of almost has that kind of stranglehold, if you like, in terms of the chemistry. So it wouldn't always necessarily be a positive thing for non-neutral players to end up in complete control of major chunks of the literature.
Well, yeah, I see the danger for sure. But on the other hand, if the content base itself remained open, Yeah, I'm just going to make a point about putting other journals under for lack of papers. just, it's got to be borne in mind the research output, at the best guess, is growing at 3% a year globally, and that's 3% on 2 million articles. That's got to go somewhere. And so no, I don't think there's any immediate effect. I think, yeah, long term, I think the mega journals may start to erode some of the tradition. Hopefully they will, to be honest, but no, that's where it's been.
One more.
I just have a question about access. So with the idea that whether the work is published in a mega journal, like a PLOS One, or a smaller journal that publishes 10 articles a month, in the end, if authors are coming to it by virtue of PubMed Central or Web of Science or some other way, what does it really matter what journal it's published in? I mean, in the spirit of true open access, right? I mean, if they're not coming into a portal, a journal portal, it's going to get discovered. And isn't that really the point?